morning, Valley Brook family. Welcome to Valley Brook Community Church on this first Sunday in the month of May. And it is a pleasure to be with you and a pleasure to have you joining us either here in person or virtually. At this time, we're going to introduce the lovely and talented sister, Neola Parson, who will give us our announcement and introduce the offertory prayer.
Morning, everyone out there in virtual land, as well as everyone here in-house. Good morning. Good morning. We want to give a very special welcome to all of our first-time viewers and visitors. We clapped a little early, but we're clapping again. And we are happy that you have chosen to worship with us here at Valley Brook this morning. Please click on the link below to access our first-time visitor card and take a few minutes to complete it. You may also find this form on our streaming page after the sermon. This will help us to pray for you and to notify you of future Valley Brook events. If you have information about a member who has become ill, or if you would like others to pray for you, please complete a prayer request e-card located under the Pastor's Corner tab or also on the streaming tab on our website, and we will be happy to lift you up. Also, every Wednesday at 8 p.m., we have our Power Hour of Prayer. You can join us, and the phone number and access code are listed on the website's homepage, as well as in today's bulletin. Offerings. For your convenience, you may contribute through our website, through our giving tab, or via mail to our office, and that address is listed in the back of the bulletin, as well as on the website. All of you who are present, just a friendly reminder, thank you for coming to join us this morning. Please be reminded that all COVID safety guidelines apply while on the premises. You should maintain a 6 feet distance. Always maintain your mask over your nose and mouth and avoid physical contact with one another. Exit the premises immediately after the benediction. And also, do not miss the fellowship and refreshments facilitated by our hospitality ministry outside after the service. Letter of thanks to the Valley Brook Community Church family. Thank you so much for all of the cards, texts, emails, calls, beautiful flowers, but most of all, thank you for your prayers for myself and my family in the recent passing of my mother, Thelma Bryant. We have been tremendously supported and blessed. Melissa Bland. We're still looking for volunteers, folks. Our sound tech team is looking for volunteers, and for a full description, please reference this morning's bulletin. As you reference this morning's bulletin, you will find the scripture reading and more complete information about the Valley Brook happening. You may also access the bulletin by streaming, by clicking on the streaming tab as on the link marched, on the link labeled virtual bulletin. But I'm so excited about birthdays, I'm just tongue-tied. So it is birthday time for May. Do we have any birthday music? We do, it's coming. But in the meantime, May 4th, we have Kia McCoy. Happy birthday, Kia. There's the music. May 8th, A.C. Abercrombie. Happy birthday, A.C. May 8th, also Calvin Gladden. Happy birthday, Calvin. Michelle Bryant. May 10th. Happy birthday, Michelle. Darren Broadnax. Happy birthday, May 11th. May 13th, we have Melissa Broadnax. Happy birthday, Melissa. And Diana Reynolds. Happy birthday, Diana. May 15th, we have Gabe Ingram. Happy birthday to you, Gabe. May 16th, Jim Allen. Happy birthday, Jim.
Good morning, family. Let's raise this up a little bit. Here we go. There we are. So I'll be reading Psalm 40, 1 through 5. And I was kind of hoping you'd say the lovely and talented Robert Craig, too, but that didn't go. Oh, I need to take this off. There we go. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on the rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Blessed is the man who makes the Lord his trust, who does not look to the proud, to those who turn aside to false gods. Many, O Lord, my God, are the wonders you have done, the things you planned for us, no one can recount to you. Were I to speak and tell of them, they would be too many to declare. You know, he could have added, and if you've got days, we could just go over and over and over the things God has done. And I also, when the firm place, have to think, the firm place he's given us is Jesus. It's that place that we have to stand on Jesus and give thanks to him. Let's pray and give him honor. Father, we do thank you and praise you for all the things you give to us, the things that we could spend days recounting and that you've done for us. We just say thank you. Over and over and over again, we say thank you. And we are grateful, grateful for how you bless us this day and the many days that you've given us. We give you the honor because you deserve it. And so we thank you for loving us, caring for us, and trusting us with your gift of Christ. And we give you the praise. We give you the honor. And so we are now giving a little bit back. So we ask that you take that and bless that in a way that many more can come to know your hand, your love, your care, your mercy, your grace. And we give you the honor, the glory, the thanks, the power, the strength forever and ever to our God through Jesus. Amen.
And again, good morning, Valley Brook family and friends, and welcome again to the first Sunday in May, and as is our tradition here, let's give the Lord a round of applause for bringing us into a new month, new blessings, great is his faithfulness. This month, we are talking about the world of work. And so without any further delay, let's just jump right in. We've got a lot to talk about this morning. The world of work. You know, it absorbs so much of our physical and mental and emotional energy and our time between going to and fro from work. And during this pandemic, we've probably not had to travel as much, but in between the times we're thinking about work, it occupies so much of our lives. So this month, what we're looking at is how our relationship with the Lord impacts our work environment and how our work environment impacts our relationship with the Lord. So today's message is titled, on-the-job training for your faith. On-the-job training for your faith. And we're going to read one of the most popular and familiar episodes in the scriptures. And it's an episode that involves the life of Daniel. Most of what we know about Daniel occurred in the context of his job. In fact, he worked for the government. He did. With distinction for over 70 years and for several administrations. And what we're going to read this morning, Bible scholars believe this event occurred when he was in his early 80s. So I'd like for you to turn with me to the book of Daniel. And we're going to read the entire chapter here, and then we're going to come back and highlight a few portions of our text. So if you'll turn to Daniel chapter 6, just 28 verses, but Daniel 6, I wanted to just read a portion and summarize it. But then as I started reading, I said, well, I can't cut that out. And then I read some more. Well, I can't cut that out. All of it held together so well, and it's such an easy narrative, and it's so inspiring that I said, oh, the joy is just in reading it. I mean, it is one of those passages where the joy is just in reading it. So, Daniel chapter 6, and we're starting in verse 1. It pleased Darius, the king, to appoint 120 satraps to rule throughout the kingdom, with three administrators over them, one of whom was Daniel. The satraps were made accountable to them so that the king might not suffer loss. Now Daniel so distinguished himself among the administrators and the satraps by his exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. At this, the administrators and the satraps tried to find grounds for charges against Daniel in his conduct of government affairs, but they were unable to do so. They could find no corruption in him because he was trustworthy and neither corrupt nor negligent. Finally, these men said, "We will never find any basis for charges against this man, Daniel, unless it has something to do with the law of his God." So the administrators and the satraps went as a group to the king and said, "O King Darius, live forever." The royal administrators, prefects, satraps, advisors, and governors have all agreed that the king should issue an edict and enforce the decree that anyone who prays to any god or man during the next 30 days, except to you, O king, shall be thrown into the lion's den. Now, O king, issue the decree and put it in writing so that it cannot be altered in accordance with the laws of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed." So King Darius put the decree in writing. Now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Then these men went as a group and found Daniel praying and asking God for help. So they went to the king and spoke to him about his royal decree. "Did you not publish a decree that during the next 30 days, anyone who prays to any god or man except to you, O king, would be thrown into the lion's den?" The king answered, "The decree stands in accordance with the laws of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed." Then they said to the king, "Daniel, who was one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, O king, or to the decree that you put in writing. He still prays three times a day." When the king heard this, he was greatly distressed. He was determined to rescue Daniel and made every effort until sundown to save him. Then the men went as a group to the king and said to him, "Remember, O king, that according to the law of the Medes and Persians, no decree or edict that the king issues can be changed." So the king gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. The king said to Daniel, "May your God, whom you serve, continually rescue you." A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the rings of his nobles, so that Daniel's situation might not be changed. Then the king returned to his palace and spent the night without eating and without any entertainment being brought to him, and he could not sleep. At the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. When he came near the den, he called to Daniel in an anguished voice, "Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to rescue you from the lions?" Daniel answered, "O king, live forever. My God sent his angel, and he shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me, because I was found innocent in his sight, nor have I ever done any wrong before you, O king." The king was overjoyed and gave orders to lift Daniel out of the den. And when Daniel was lifted from the den, no wound was found on him because he had trusted in his God. At the king's command, the men who had falsely accused Daniel were brought in and thrown into the lion's den, along with their wives and children. And before they reached the floor of the den, the lions overpowered them and crushed all their bones. Then King Darius wrote to all the peoples, nations, and men of every language throughout the land, "May you prosper greatly. I issue a decree that in every part of my kingdom, people must fear and reverence the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, and he endures forever. His kingdom will not be destroyed. His dominion will never end. He rescues and he saves. He performs signs and wonders in the heavens and on the earth. He has rescued Daniel from the power of the lions." So Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Amen and amen. Let's take a moment to pray and ask the Lord to help us to go through this and to digest some of these wonderful truths. Lord, we thank you for blessing us this morning with your faithfulness. We are here because of your faithfulness. We are here because of your goodness. We ask that you would just bless our hearts to be open to receive what you want us to have this morning. Lord, we all sit at your feet this morning. We all sit before you, and we ask that your Holy Spirit would minister to each one of us in our specific place. Lord, as some of us are in the workplace, some of us have been in the workplace, some of us are getting ready to go into the workplace, we ask, Lord, that your truth would permeate every situation and touch every heart. In the precious name of Jesus, amen. All right, so again, this episode most likely occurred when Daniel was in his early 80s. And one of the repeated themes throughout the scripture that we find is, you know, here Daniel is in his early 80s, and what this connects with is this truth that in the pages of scripture, in biblical history, you are never too old for God to do something new. You are never too old for God to surprise you and to show up in a way that was totally unexpected. The life that God has given us, the precious thing about it is that it continues to unveil his wonders as long as we're on this planet. And so here he is in his early 80s, and And he has this episode. Don't ever think that you've seen it all. Don't ever think, because the Lord, when it comes to, as it says there, what is it, verse 26, when it talks about the living God, when the word awesome is used in reference to him, it's more than just a phrase that the kids use. It is who he is. He is awesome. And so it's his very nature. Daniel's experience, if you want to think of it this way, and these are not the points I want to make, so don't say point one, two, three, or four, because this is not it. But here's, just for you note takers, just to give you a heads up. Daniel's experience, as I was thinking about this, can be framed in a way that we can all identify with. The good, the bad, the ugly, and the divine. The good is work. You know, work offers great rewards. Work is a blessing. There are all kinds of things that happen positively in our lives as a result of work. There's personal growth that we experience. There are relationships that we experience. I often tell you all that I met Michael Yakey on the job many years ago. I didn't know that it would be many years later that he'd still be here and I'd still be with him. But that's one of the benefits of work, our relationships. Positively contributing to society. It's one of the blessings that we enjoy from work. You know, I can't think of many places, as I think about my tax dollars, I can't think of many places where I rejoice more in paying a salary through my taxes than that of the trash collectors. That is money well spent. And all they have to do is not show up 1 week, and we can see the value of what they do. We would all like to believe that the world is a better place because of the work that we do. We would all like to think that we're not just going to work from 8 to 5 to draw a paycheck. We would like to think that we are making a contribution, and that's one of the blessings of work. So that's the good. And then there's the bad. Jealous people, and they can and they will conspire against us. You know, how many people are influenced to compromise their values because of the fear of being ostracized or targeted? It's a real thing. That's the bad of the work environment. Then there's the ugly. The ugliest things can always get worse. You think that they're bad, and then they get worse. They go from ugly to horrible. And then there's the divine. And the divine is that God has a way of working things out in ways that surprise us, marvel us, and cause us to fall down on our knees in worship before him. And we've seen him do that as well. So if you're taking notes, here's the main idea. Every single element of your workday, every single element of your workday is on the job training for your faith in God. Every single element of your workday is on the job training for your faith in God. Work is not just necessary to put food on the table. What it is it's precious conditioning for a stronger and a more authentic relationship with the Lord. It is precious conditioning for a stronger and a more authentic relationship with the Lord. Everything is. Everything in life is, no matter what series we're going over, whether it's family, whether it's work, whether it's spiritual warfare, whatever it is conditioning for a stronger and a deeper and a more authentic, a more vital, a more real relationship with the Lord. And work is no exception. Daniel was an administrator over the satraps, who in ancient Persia, they were governors of provinces. Under our system, it would be like he had a cabinet position in the White House. And he was in line for an even higher position. King Darius was going to make him, place him over the entire kingdom, second only to Darius himself. And then everything fell apart, or so it seemed. So there's several observations I want to make about this event that we just read that we've heard about since Sunday school. And the first one is this. God works inside out. God works inside out. We do our work. God does all these magnificent things in the world. He created the world. He spoke it into existence. When it comes to our lives, he works from the inside out. There was something going on inside of Daniel beyond his mere talent, beyond his human intelligence, that marked him as a man of exceptional qualities, it says. Exceptional qualities, according to verse 3. The word that's translated qualities is literally spirit. It's literally spirit. In fact, the King James Version, for those of you who are reading it, it translates it excellent spirit. He had an excellent spirit. And also the New American Standard Bible translates it that way. Over the course of all those years on the job, God had continued to refine Daniel's faith so that it translated into an excellent spirit. In verse 4, it says that he was not corrupt, that he was not negligent. Now, we know Daniel was not perfect. How do we know? Because Daniel was a human being. We know that in the execution of his duties and in just living his life, he wasn't a perfect man. We know he was human and that no doubt he had human reactions at times. But his on-the-job training with God had helped to insulate him from letting the job beat him down and make him cynical or make him bitter. He had an excellent spirit. So that is what hope in God does. It creates within us a positive and an excellent spirit when our trust and our hope is in him. Daniel was committed to his job, but his commitment to his job flowed from his faith. It wasn't in competition with his faith. It flowed from his faith. In other words, job success was not more important to him than his relationship with his God. Job success was not more important to him than his relationship with his God. And contrary to what we may think, that priority didn't detract from his excellence in work. On the contrary, it made him a worker with an excellent spirit as well as excellent skill. So he had an excellent quality about him because of his relationship with the Lord. Secondly, God's objective. What is God up to in the workplace? I mentioned this before. He's always after producing for us a stronger faith in him. No matter what is going on at work, no matter what the details may be, no matter how it may look, no matter how we may be experiencing it, no matter what anybody may be saying, no matter what anybody else may be doing, God has a singular objective. He has a singular objective. And if we can grasp this, it can help to stabilize us when the work world is unstable. He has a singular objective, and that is to give us a stronger faith in him. Now let's look at what Daniel was doing when the men caught him violating the king's edict. What was he doing? If you look at verse 11, it tells us what was Daniel doing when the men caught him violating the king's edict. It says in verse 11, it says he was praying and asking God for help. Doesn't that sound strange? You know, this is probably why some people say, be careful what you ask for. Because here he is in the midst of a prayer asking God for help. God, what do I do? I'm not here to rebel against the king. I'm here to honor you. I'm praying for help. What should I do? The king has issued an edict that is in direct contradiction to my faith, and I don't know what to do. I want to be excellent on my job. I want to continue to have an excellent spirit. I want to continue to be what you have made me to be. And here is this conflict. Here is this obstacle right in my face. I'm asking you for help. What do I do? And while he's praying about what to do, the men say, aha, and caught him. Now that could make you feel like, you know what, Lord, I don't like your sense of humor. This is not funny. They could have come at any other time in my prayer, but here I am asking you for help. And at that moment, when I'm asking you for help, they show up and catch me in the act. Sometimes things seem to get worse after we pray. Sometimes things seem to get worse after we pray. And that's, as I said, why some people say be careful. But see, you should not be afraid of that. Because, you see, what God was really doing here is the reason why it seemed like it got worse is so that the answer would be more glorious. So that the answer would be more glorious. The answer would be more evident. The answer would be more apparent. The answer would show Daniel more clearly, I heard you. I heard you. We often call this the story of Daniel in the lion's den. But that's not really the story. It's really not about Daniel in the lion's den, because there's no story there. When people are thrown to the lions, the natural thing that happens is they're eaten up. The real story here is God in the lion's den with Daniel. That's the real story. We should call it God in the lion's den with Daniel. That's the difference. And had it not gotten worse, quote unquote, we wouldn't be reading about it right here. There would be no story. What stories are we most excited to tell people about? When it comes to our faith, what stories are we, Brother John? What stories are we most excited to tell? Brother John sent me a text and was just talking about the episodes of his life over the past few years. And what I noticed about this text was that there was a lot of trials and travails and troubles and bumps and ups and downs. But he was telling it because the story had gotten worse before it got better, but then God showed up, and it was more glorious than he could have ever imagined. And so it is. Sometimes it seems to get worse. It seems to get worse so that the answer is more apparent, and so it's more glorious. And so we know that God heard us. Daniel came out of this with more than a promotion. He came out of it with a stronger confidence and security in the God he served. He had not personally experienced this side of the Lord before. Daniel had not experienced anything like this personally in his experience of the Lord. Now, what he had seen earlier on in his ministry when the king had threatened to kill everybody because they couldn't interpret the dream, he had seen God come through and give him the power to interpret a dream and thus averting disaster. He had also seen his friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, thrown in a fiery furnace and preserved by the living God. But he himself had never been in a situation like this in all of his years. And so it's one thing for somebody to give you their testimony. It's another thing when it happens to you. So Daniel had seen God come through, and he had seen God's miraculous power, but not like this. Not like this, not when he was in death's throes. Not when the lions were looking at him. Not when death was staring him directly in the face. And that's how it is. You know, everybody can tell you what God is like. And everybody can make it sound good. But it sounding good is not going to do a thing for you, really, where the rubber meets the road. You know what's going to make it really work for you is when you yourself have experienced him. When you yourself have seen him shut the lion's mouth. When you yourself have seen him take a supernatural blessing and placed it in your life. Where all you could do is to say, that had to be God. There are things that God wants to show us about himself in the chaos of work. Just as there were things that God wanted to show Daniel about himself in that lion's den. There are things that God wants to show us when the lions are facing us at work and when it looks like it's disaster, lurking, pacing, growling, all the stuff that lions do, threatening, menacing, and you know that one move and you are shred to ribbons. You know that one person, that person has the right on your job to make your life absolute hell. Those people, you know who they are. You're seeing their faces. Those people. But see, God wants to do something in the chaos of work to show you something about himself that you've not seen before. You know, Brother Don, you always say that you got a bad boss. Don works for himself. It's his own business. So he says, I hate my boss. Even when your boss is bad, there are things that he wants to show you in the chaos of work, in dealing with other people, dealing with customers, dealing with the people that give you the contracts, dealing with fellow workers, dealing with whomever you deal with. There are things in the context of your work, in the chaos, he wants to show you that you would not see otherwise, that will bolster our confidence and security in him. That's why. Not to you know, not playing some game where he's trying to traumatize us, but to deepen our security and our confidence in him. Our journey is not perfect. And the way we handle it is not always going to be pretty. And we would like to say that we were like Daniel. We would like to be able to have that on our resume. But sometimes our humanness takes over. And sometimes we sabotage our own success by our reactions, by our human reactions. It's okay. You know why it's okay? Because even though that will create tribulation, we have a God who is a redeemer. And what he will do is, see, that's a different kind of lion's den. What he will do is translate that into blessings that you never saw coming. It's called grace. It's called grace. So don't think that it's all because I'm walking the straight and narrow and I'm doing it all well like Daniel. No, no, no. It's because of the grace of God on your life. And because of your eternal favor with him. Even when you go left when he wanted you to go right. Even when you sit down when he wanted you to stand up. Even when you say no when he wanted you to say yes. There are things in the chaos of the work environment and in the chaos of your response. In the chaos of your response. When you are your worst enemy. When your own attitudes and thoughts are the lions. You hear what I'm saying? When your attitudes and thoughts, when your poor responses are the lions, he can shut their mouths too. And you say, oh, it's just the mighty grace of God. What he's doing is crafting our faith. It's not always pretty, but event by event, episode by episode, response by response, the Lord is masterfully crafting our faith in him. Our faith in him. And again, as I've said many times before, he doesn't just want us to do the right thing for him. He wants us to believe the right things about him. He wants us to believe the right things about him when we are in the lion's den. He wants us to believe the right things about him. Third, God works it out his way. God works it out his way. Don't fear the chaos, it's coming. But it's never random. It may seem random. It may be malicious. It may be intentional. It may be absolutely intended to destroy you. They may mean it for evil. But you know the rest of that, don't you? They may mean it for evil, but Romans 8 tells us that God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purposes. And as Joseph said to his brothers who really wanted to do him in, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. God is at work in the midst of the chaos. When it's raining and storming, God is at work. You know, I always say I don't want to be in control because God is so much more creative than I am. And he is. The way he works it out is so much more amazing and creative than I have the power to create. Do you think Daniel would have drawn his career path up this way? Let's see. Captivity, jealous workmates, the threat of termination, and not just losing my job, literal life termination. A lion's den. Probably not. See, the Lord's love is not just sentimental. His love for us is not just sentimental. It's also full of wisdom. He's not only moved by his emotions toward us, but his long-term view of our joy in him and the fulfillment of his purposes through us. That's why there is at times a disconnect, it seems, between our perception of what our love needs are from him and what he actually provides. Because his love is not just sentimental. It's based on his knowledge of us, his wisdom, his purposes, and it's not always going to fit within the feel-good zone of our psyche, of our emotional makeup. But that doesn't mean it's not love. It just means it doesn't feel good right now. That's all it means. That's all it means. It doesn't mean that God doesn't see. It doesn't mean that God doesn't care. Now, those are the things that the evil one will whisper in your ear. It doesn't mean that God's mad at you, that he's punishing you. It doesn't mean that he doesn't want you to have a happy life. It doesn't mean that he doesn't want you to have the thing that you really want. All it means is it doesn't feel good right now. That's all it means to us. From God's standpoint, it's wisdom. From God's standpoint, it's faithfulness. From God's standpoint, it is love beyond imagination. From God's standpoint, it is affection. It is all of those things that the scripture says he is. But for us in that moment, all it means is it doesn't feel good right now. We can say that and still be full of faith. You hear me? You can say that because that's real. That's true. Daniel would not have been a man in error if he had said, it's scary in here, God. He would not have been less of a man of faith if he had said, he sure came close to me then, Lord. He would not have been less a man of faith if his Lord, he brushed up against me. I could smell his breath. That is not, all that is acknowledging the reality. It is not in any way casting aspersions on the character or the nature of God. It is simply acknowledging the reality of my human experience in this moment. And that is what being honest and authentic and pouring out your heart before the Lord looks like in the context of faith. As we remember Jesus in Gethsemane. Well, he was talking about what it was like. But nowhere in any of his prayers do you see any kind of a view of God that suggests that God did not love him or care about him. Or didn't know what was going on. In fact, Jesus said, Lord, in all of this, this is what I want. If you could make it feel better. Can you make it feel better, Father? Take this cup away. He's not saying, I don't want to go to the cross. But what I'm experiencing here, if you could take this cup away, yet not as I will, but as thou will. Not my will, but your will be done. And that's why we have communion when it doesn't feel good. That's what communion is for. That's why it's so important. For that time when it doesn't feel good, when it's scary, when it looks like disaster, when it smells like disaster, when it tastes like disaster, when it looks like God has gone to sleep or gone home from his job. taking care of me. That's why we remember the cross. That's why he said God demonstrates. That's why we had last week's message. God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That's what the Lord wants us to hold on to. You know why? Because then we are secure. Then we are confident. Despite the fact that it doesn't feel good, that's when you have that mingling of sorrow and joy, of pain and pleasure that wells up in tears that are hard to explain. Because yes, I'm hurting, but I'm also hoping. Yes, I'm sorrowful, but I'm also rejoicing. Yes, I'm beaten down, but I'm not crushed. See, you don't experience that unless you go to the lion's den. There's no way you can experience that. How is God going to show that to us? How is that going to be revealed? How are we going to deepen in our confidence that he can handle anything? I can't, but he can handle anything. That's why I said, Lord, I am so thankful for your voice. Psalm 29 says the voice of the Lord is powerful. And I said, the voice, it's a voice like no other. The Lord speaks. He just speaks and it becomes. He speaks and it changes. He speaks and it departs. He speaks and we see. He speaks and we persevere. He speaks and we understand. He speaks and we rest. He speaks and the lions shut their mouths. And the morning comes. And our friends say, are you okay? Has the God that you've trusted in been able to save you? I'm still here. Oh, Bill, live forever. The God whom I've trusted has somehow kept me here. Somehow. I tell you, boy, that's the thing about this journey with Christ. When he is our focal point and trusting him, getting to know him, when deepening our faith in him is our focal point, life with him, when that's our objective, you never know when, you never know where, you never know what, you never know how much, you never know what you're going to discover and how it's going to impact your life or the lives of others. Any day. Can be a one day that changes your life. Daniel didn't see this day coming, but it is a day he would never forget. And boy, I tell you, that's how it is, boy. There are days we never saw them coming, but boy, we never forget. See, God is as real on your job as he is in your church. He's as real on your job and as active on your job as he is in your private devotional time. He is with you wherever you go. And when we think of real life and exclude him, when our perception of real life excludes him, the perception has become a deception. Because he is as present with you, Brother Don, up on that roof as he is as you're sitting there right here. He is as present wherever we are as he is in this moment. So keep your eye on the ball. Keep your eye on the ball, brothers and sisters. If I can just share my heart with you, keep your eye on the ball. Recognize what God is doing. Tune in to what he, and it's not complicated. It can sometimes be slippery. It can be elusive. It can be shrouded. It can be buried in the chaos. You can lose sight of it. But be prayerfully connected with him. And help him and ask him to help you to see what it is that he is doing. And in a big, broad, general sense, what he is doing is calling our hearts to one thing. Trust me. Trust me. Trust me. Because the most precious thing that we have, more precious than gold, is our faith. It's more precious than anything else we have. This is what Peter, when he says it's more precious than gold, that's what he's talking about. There is nothing else that you have in your life that is more precious than your faith in God. He knows that. Because that is the only thing that can give us the deepest security, confidence, satisfaction. That's the real prize of life. So the most precious thing that we have, more precious than gold, is our faith. And the Lord's on-the-job training is intended to refine it day by day so it becomes even more precious to us. And as our faith in him becomes more precious to us, so does he become more precious to us. And ultimately, that is what our souls crave the most. So may God give us grace in this on-the-job training for our faith. And may we welcome it because of his faithfulness, not because of our strength or our own ability to navigate it or our own toughness, but because of his faithfulness. And I'm done. And, amen, praise the Lord. And we have Brother George, who is going to now give us a worship offering virtually, not here live. But you can refresh your screens, and he will deliver for you, I am sure, a blessing, as he always does. God bless you all. And, you know, let me just close in prayer here. I'm going to close in prayer and ask the Lord to just cement some of these things in our heart. Lord, it might have been one thing, it might have been two. It might have been three, it might have been four, it may have been, you know, how many things, Lord, you wanted to share with us. But whatever it is, help us to hold on to it by faith and to nurture it before you and to trust you to make it a reality in our experience this week. We thank you, Lord, for our situations, whatever they may be. We thank you, Lord. It is tough out there, but you know that. It is scary out there, but you know that. There is much that can make us feel insecure, but you know that. Our faith is sometimes shaky, but you know that. We ask that your Holy Spirit would do what he does so well. Comfort, counsel, console, and strengthen us. And guide us as we seek, Lord, this week, a closer walk with you. In the precious name of Jesus, amen.
Awesome. but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only. Nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty. Glory, you're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn garden, you turn bones into armies, you turn seas into highways.